Today we have a presentation by Mr. Todd Petrie. He's a director of asset management for Veolia, and we're also honored, and he's our project manager for our Water Works program, and he's going to provide a presentation on the current status of some of the construction projects that we have on the water and wastewater side.
Todd Petrie with Veolia, and I assist the city with managing the utilities capital program. So tonight is an update a little bit as to where we are with the program. We've made a lot of headway, and we wanted to cover some of those. This photograph is of Corollo Engineers, which is assisting the city in evaluating the water quality. They have done a lot of analysis on the actual water quality that comes out of the ground and the best way to treat it in regards to the hydrogen sulfide and any of the aesthetics issues that may be there. We've received the reports, the draft report. We provided comments back on that, and are waiting for the final analysis, some scientific and chemistry that they're working on. The next project is the high service pump suction header replacement. There were several different issues, and this photograph identifies primarily what is involved with this project. It is replacing the header that goes from the ground storage tanks to the high service pump building. There were several different issues involved with that, one of them being performance of the high service pump or flow. In addition, some water quality and focus on water quality to be able to change the point at which chlorine was dosed to try and reduce and improve how some of those aesthetics may be. So this particular project was actually fast-tracked. Normally, design takes a very long time with 30, 60, 90, 100s. From the time that we started this project, where we are now is it was actually bid, it is actually advertised today for bidding over the next four to six weeks or so. Will be the appropriate bidding process in compliance with the state rules, and then there will be a proposal submitted selection committee with the intention to bring it before this commission for consideration in December. So it has taken it from a concept all the way to bidding in a very, very short period of time. So what it is it's replacing the piping from the ground storage tank to the high service pumping and achieve several different things. Number one is it will change the location at which disinfectant chlorine is applied. So it should, and from the calculations, that's part of the objective, is to improve the water aesthetics as well as the performance of the high service pumps.
So, Todd, you and I have conversations all the time, and,
yes,
and there's a lot of people in the room that know a lot less about water than you do. Mm-hmm. And be honest, correct me if I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm. I
mean, so what this project really does is it changes the point at which we add the disinfectant to the water source.
That's correct.
It's right now the disinfectant, which is the chlorine, is being added essentially at the head of the plant. I mean, your water's coming out of the pump, out of the well, we're adding chlorine, it goes into a big, giant tank. And if anybody has ever taken some dye, and you can drop it into your pool, and you watch it kind of, I don't know what you want to call it, it diffuses into the water very slowly. And it's not the most efficient process. So what they've come up with, Corolla, Kinley Horn, and CPH, and Veolia, is there's probably a more effective and efficient way to do it. And the best I can explain it is, instead of injecting the chlorine in the front of the plant, we're going to do it more toward the back of the plant. And we're doing it in a different way. It's the difference between, and I'm oversimplifying this, dropping a drop of dye into a pool or taking that dye and putting it into a blender and turning the blender on. The chlorine comes in contact with the water sources much more efficiently and effectively. The second part of it is the chlorine is in contact with the water a little less time because it's not moving through this big, you know, this big storage tank and kind of coalescing and diffusing. So those two combinations do a couple things. You get to use less chlorine, which is one of the complaints that we've heard, is there's a lot of chlorine in the water. And the second point is it has less contact time. And we're not going to sit here and pull the wool out of your eyes. There are things in the water, and Todd will have to go through that if anybody's interested, that when they come in contact with chlorine, they have a reaction. And what we're trying to do is minimize the contact, but maximize the disinfecting ability of that chlorine. Is that, I know it's oversimplification, but.
That's a very good explanation.
Okay.
That's correct. The intention is to change the point at which chlorine is applied to the water. So there will be an appropriate amount of time instead of an extended amount of time that the chlorine is in contact with the water and that may create some of the aesthetic issues. So it's the appropriate amount of time. DEP, there is a department, Florida Department of Environmental Protection permit that has to be issued for this work. That's part of Corolla's scope. They have to look at and agree with that, yes, this is an appropriate method and that it still meets four-log virus inactivation and all of the things required to be in compliance with state and federal rules. So they are also involved in the process. Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. In association with that project is evaluating each of the wells. This particular photograph was well number one at water treatment plant number one. There are actually four wells at water treatment plant one. So again, Corolla Engineering with Connect Consulting, which is a specialty firm that looks at wells and evaluates wells, is evaluated that. Right now, well number three has been removed and evaluating the actual pump piece of it. And actually last week, Corolla and Connect Consulting was out evaluating the actual well itself through CCTV inspection and assessing the water quality, the capacity, as well as the quality directly out of the well. With the objective of trying to identify where the best quality of water is coming from and pull from those areas.
So, Todd, does that, with the new pumps, does that help increase the volume of water that can be pumped out of the wells?
That is correct. Specifically at well number one here, the capacity was significantly reduced. After the pump was removed and inspected, it was found that the actual impeller, which is the mechanical device within the well that actually moves the water, was corroded. It was in the neighborhood of like half the size it should have been. Oh. So we will see a benefit in that there will be increased water production out of the existing infrastructure. And well number three has some of those characteristics, or the pump itself has some of those characteristics. So we're looking at replacing that pump also to have improved performance, more water capacity.
Okay, thank you.
Engineers are great at what they do, but sometimes when it comes to explaining, they don't tell you.
I am the engineer.
Yeah, exactly. So there's a lot of things that happen with this project, one of which Todd pointed out, and that is when we pulled the wells that are actually embedded in the well, we found that they had a composite blade. Anybody that owns a boat or owns a fan, a ceiling fan, what happened is when we pulled it, we realized that the makeup of the water reacted poorly to those composite blades. And like Todd said, they were about half the size. So here these poor little pumps were going like crazy, but pulling very little water volume through them. So not exactly rocket science, but we looked at it and we said, how about a stainless steel prop? propeller, impeller, what they call it. And what we found is that those were much more efficient. Now these pumps are running less and producing significantly more water volume. Tell me if I'm wrong, but it was going from about 200 gallons a minute. Now we're up to the potential to run 800 gallons a minute, plus or minus.
It was a little higher than that, but it was along that range of improvement.
Yeah.
By replacing the pump and having new impellers installed.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this is all unscripted, believe it or not, but I've heard this every week over and over again, and I see some blank faces out there like, why are they doing this? The other thing we did was when we pulled the pumps and they're inserted in the wellheads themselves, we thought, hey, we got these pumps pulled out. And the engineers all got together, a bunch of groups of them got together, and they said, you know, we're working really hard to treat the water that we're getting. Maybe if we put a camera down in these wells, we can determine a couple things. We can determine the quality of the water coming out of the ground and the capability of the well producing more water if we need to be. In Florida, there's a couple different layers, right? And I'm not going to talk about it because I don't know about it. But what I did is I did go in the room and I watched the video camera, and you could see they went down 200 feet. Mm-hmm. Very clearly can see the different layers of the aquifer, because the idea was if we could pull cleaner water out, we could treat it less. We would have to treat it less. And so we did that, and we determined that we were shocked at the volume that these wells could produce water. So the good news is Winter Springs is in very good shape. From a capacity standpoint, we can pull a great deal of water out of these wells. And the second one is the water in the well is actually of pretty high quality. So, and the test will demonstrate that if anybody wants to question it. And so that was one of the projects. Now we're going systematically to well. And we've got a couple different pumping stations around the city. And we're examining each one of those wells, because ultimately what that says to the customer is we may be able to produce a higher quality water at a lower cost. And we always look at that dichotomy as higher quality, lower cost. So I'm sorry, back to you, Mr. Todd.
No. All right. Also on water quality, this particular apparatus on the fire hydrant is an automatic flusher. So what that does is in areas where it may be needed, where water may sit a little longer than specifically outlined, the automatic flusher will come on and it flushes the water out, which makes sure that we have the best quality water within the time frame that's delivered to the customers. So in the case of Devera, it has done the task that it was supposed to do. And now the total trihalomethane, that's the TTHM levels, have been reduced. The state has reduced the sampling in that area. Specifically in Devera, that water is actually provided from the county. That's actually not city water system provided to Devera. But the action of flushing more and moving that water through has resulted in reduced sampling and approved by the state.
Mr. Cannon?
So we have a little over 30 customers that get water billed through the city of Winter Springs, but the water originates from water facilities owned and operated exclusively by Seminole County.
Is that right?
Okay.
That's correct.
And these homes are located over by the Oviedo Mall. Mm-hmm. And they're kind of at the end of the run, I guess, from the Seminole County water plant. And those are the ones referred to as Dovera. So if you looked at our 2019 water quality reports, one report was for all of the City of Winter Springs water programs.
That's great.
There was a separate report for Dovera, and the water in that report that had an elevated trihalomethane during the year of 2019 originated from Seminole County water sources, correct?
That's correct.
And they have their own permits, and we as a city cannot dictate to them how to manage their water plants, right?
That's correct.
Okay. Just like they couldn't tell us how to run our plants. But in any event, if the clerk could open up the PowerPoint that we looked at on July 8 of 2019, and there's a slide that shows how disinfection byproducts are formed. And this was a presentation by one of our outside consulting engineers, CPH. So I want to make sure I understand this, because recently there's been a lot of people asking me questions, Todd, mm-hmm. because of things that they've been seeing on social media, and I want to make sure. So the first circle on the left, and I gave copies of this for the commissioners as well, precursors naturally occurring, says total organic carbon and bromides. So what is that? Those are just naturally occurring chemicals that are in the groundwater here in Florida?
That's correct.
Okay.
They're naturally occurring.
And then we are required by state and federal law to chlorinate the water for sanitation reasons, right?
That's correct.
So you add the chlorine to it, which is the disinfectant. And then that third, the third circle there says time and temperature. Explain that, because I think it comes into play with these automatic flushers, these red boxes that we see around town on the hydrants.
That's
so
correct.
Time and temperature, what happens the longer the naturally occurring organic carbon content of our water sits in the pipelines with chlorination? What happens with time?
So with time, it's a complex calculation that goes in, but basically the longer chlorine is in contact with those naturally occurring elements, then the trihalomethanes increase. It's a basic chemical reaction that happens. And the same thing with temperature. Temperature affects that also. Is typically a water system will see an increase over the summer months,
okay.
because the temperature outside, it's 90, 95 degrees. The ground warms up a little bit. And even those couple of degrees will make a difference. In the fall, winter, if Florida has a winter, in fall, winter, and springtime, those temperatures, even a couple of degrees, will make a difference in the formation of those trihalomethanes or those disinfection byproducts.
So we have found historically in the city that those pockets of the city that are at the end of the pipeline, for lack of a better word, seem to be where the trihalomethanes accumulate to a little bit higher levels. And is that just because there's a limited amount of water flushing through the lines? It's sort of the end of the line?
Typically, or at the end of the line, if there's not a lot of use there, then the time frame goes from a shorter period of time to a longer period of time. And the
okay.
longer the chlorine is in contact with those constituents, with the TOC and the hydrogen sulfide, then it becomes those trihalomethanes.
I've lived in Winter Springs for several years now, and when I go on vacation for a week or two and I come back, I find that when I open my faucets up, I have a stronger odor coming out of them, and I turn them on and just run the water for a few minutes and flush them out. So when you flush these lines with the automatic flushing devices, does that have the impact of bringing those trihalomethane levels down?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
And it works the way, Commissioner, the way you described it in your home is the same way that it happens in the distribution lines. That little bit of flush moves that out, and then any of the trihalomethanes are in there, those will come down immediately.
And you're a professional engineer working in the water specialty areas for how many years?
25.
Okay, sorry. Is this a common, is this type of an operational flushing something that's routinely done by water companies around the country?
Absolutely.
Okay.
The only difference is whether it's an automatic or whether it's a person that goes
going out,
and
opening a hydrant
yeah,
or whatever.
It's,
okay.
It's more efficient to use technology to do auto flushing instead of sending a person in a truck and a wrench to go do these kinds of things. Right? This slide switches from the potable water side to the wastewater side of the business. This is the sludge dewatering trailer, which the city purchased over the summer. It was approved by commission. It has been placed into operation, and it is functioning. It arrived. It's in service. It's doing the job that it needs to do. And it it has been a success. Functions very well. We've gotten very, very good performance out of it. Wastewater treatment plant improvements. So again, this is on the wastewater side of the operation. The commission approved SGS contracting services to do improvements at the wastewater plants. What this project is to increase or do certain repairs on the wastewater treatment plants to extend the life of those facilities a little bit longer, get a little more useful life. Most of these plants were installed in the 80s and early 90s, so they have been out there for a very, very long time. They're steel. They were painted at one time, but they corrode. Whether it's a boat or metal around your home, it's the same situation. Over time, steel corrodes. That's a naturally occurring event. So the commission has approved the contractor due to the work. They also approved a dewatering contractor. This particular photo is unloading the screening equipment, which is equipment that will be installed up front. It removes inorganics such as plastic and certain other material that the biology doesn't eat. It'll remove those. The city purchased these up front as owner-supplied equipment, saving money, saving markup, as well as saving the taxes that would normally be charged on this because the city doesn't pay taxes. Those dollars were saved, and we facilitated doing that. As it stands right now, it was delayed a little bit because of one of the suppliers. It happens across all different types of businesses in the world today. The aerators are actually a stainless steel component, and stainless steel ultimately has to come from somewhere. Whether we're talking about items for wastewater treatment plants, pipe for water plants, or even your home air conditioner. I was talking with someone else recently. Air conditioners are delayed. If someone has a problem with an air conditioner, it's very likely they may experience delays in getting that replacement simply because the components are not available. So we experienced some delays because of delivery of components from the suppliers. But at this particular point, the dewatering is expected to start occurring at the end of this month. The dewatering company should come in November, with construction beginning in November to December. So moving back to the drinking water side of the operation, let's talk a little bit about Water Treatment Plant 2 and Water Treatment Plant 3 power reliability. This particular photo is actually a standby pump at one of the lift stations. But again, using that philosophy to have backup systems in place to be able to handle an emergency so that the utility continues to run uninterrupted, we go to power reliability at Water Treatment Plant 2 and 3. At Water Treatment Plant 2, there's electrical improvements to install a new generator, to install an automatic transfer switch, so if there's any interruption in power to water treatment plant number 2, that there will be a generator in place and the entire plant will run automatically like nothing has changed. Right now, there is a backup operation, but it's, lack of a better term, it's clunky. Requires a lot of manual operation to make it happen. So we can operate the plant. We have physically exercised it in that mode to operate the plant. But this will ensure that the operation remains completely unaffected in the event there's a storm or some event that affects power to that facility.
Mr. Mayor, Deputy Mayor. I just had a question for you. What condition was this in when you found it, the electrical?
Challenging.
What does that mean?
It was bad. It was bad. Water treatment plant 2 has a propane engine of, I have no idea when that was installed. It is very old. It's very loud. it's not the best operating condition. Water treatment plant 3 actually utilizes power from a lift station 1,200 feet away. And part of the testing that was completed, it actually showed that the wire is disintegrating, and there is concern. There is argument amongst the experts as to how much it is degrading, but it's anywhere between within 12 months to 24 months. They do not trust that wire.
So again, you're being modest again. What they found is a hodgepodge of wires that ran two of our primary water supply
facilities,
plants. Mm-hmm. What they also found out is the way it was jury-rigged was a great big lightning rod. And we kept spending enormous amounts of money fixing these things because they kept attracting lightning. And so what we did is we stopped, we analyzed it, and we created a much more independent, redundant system. So they're being modest again. I didn't plan on doing this, but can I digress for 1 second sure. to the prior slide? Because I'm seeing a lot of blank faces. Why would we spend, and I can go through some of the spending that we have, all the projects, but when we started to analyze the plants, we have two primary, I call them two plants, there's really four systems, but it's two plants for treating waste water. It's the sewage. We were in a panic about, that's what happens when you breathe into it, about 2 years ago, because the conditions of the plants were so decayed that we weren't really sure how we were going to get through the next 3 to 4 years. And why is that important? Because replacement of these plants are very expensive. We turned in a report about a year ago to the commission for replacement of plants, and the cheapest option was $40 million. We brought Veolia in, and they immediately began to do an analysis. They brought in other professional engineers to look at it. And what we were successful so far, and the truth will be known when we drain these plants. We're going to drain each one individually, and we're going to look under the water line because we can't see it right now, because it's, if you ever go out to a plant, it's a brown water. You can't see underneath the surface. But the plan right now is we may be able to defer that $40 million up to 10 years from today by doing these emergency repairs. We're going to drain them. We're going to look at the equipment. We're going to replace what we can. We think we can defer that. If you do the math, if you're a finance person, and you look at cost of time value of money, you look at the loans that we could get right now, even if we got grant money, this is a significant savings to the tax dollars and to the utility customers, significant. And they're being modest again, but if all said, I mean, this is going to save millions and millions of dollars of deferred replacement cost for hopefully somewhere between 7-10 years. So they're breezing over these things, but I want you guys to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it. We don't do anything haphazardly. We certainly don't do anything financially irresponsible, because we don't know how to do that. Go ahead, Todd. I'm sorry.
So in associated with the wastewater plants, absolutely. There's corrosion in the steel. There's actually holes through the steel that we can see through. There are walkways up on top of the plants that our staff has to walk around on a regular basis. Part of those are some of the supports have rotted out. So that's what this work is intended to do, is to fix those and gain that additional time. And as Mr. Boyle was saying, the interest rate that's charged, when you borrow that amount of money and the interest rate charged, it's significant. So if we can do appropriate repairs, extend the amount of time before, and make good decisions along the way, we can extend that time frame before we have to expend those kinds of dollars.
Commissioner Cannon? Mm-hmm. So, Todd, you've been a professional engineer for 25 years. Until about 2 years ago, for the 4 years I sat on this commission, I never heard about any of this. But what it sounds like to me is there was a lot of deferred maintenance, a lot of the routine maintenance, you know, these impellers and these pumps and rotting away of, you know, steel that wasn't properly painted. So is that deferred maintenance something that you would attribute to a lot of the deficiencies that you found once you got in looking at these systems?
We would look at, there is work that we would have completed long before now.
Okay.
And it needs to be done. This first year where we've been in operation, we've replaced a lot of that, and that's the first thing. If the pump doesn't work right, it gets repaired, it gets replaced.
Right.
Some of these particular repairs are simply things that you need specialists for. You need welders. They have to access them safely,
right,
with the appropriate safety equipment to be able to do it. In some cases, the facility actually has to be empty of water to be able to get to those areas to physically do those repairs.
So one of the questions I've got for you, Sean, is that you already gave us a report. We know we're looking at magnitude, tens of millions of dollars to do full replacements. And, you know, it's kind of like when you have the car and you don't change the oil regularly and you don't change the tires regularly and you don't service the brakes regularly, and then rather than doing incremental repairs and maintenance on it, then all of a sudden, bam, you get hit with a huge bill. So do you believe that if we can achieve the 7 to 10 year extension through these methods, that we can take that $30-40 million and stretch it out over a longer period of time so that we can avoid having to jack up utility rates by substantial amounts? Is that basically your goal here?
That's basically the goal. And just to play off your analogy, where I come from in my family, we don't replace the entire car.
Yeah.
If the tires are bad, we replace the tires. We don't replace the entire plant. I've seen some discussion about just replace it all. Replacing the entire infrastructure, and I'm swagging, I mean, you're talking in excess of $100 million.
Yeah.
Put that on the backs of 14,000 customers. We just can't go there.
Yeah.
We are not sacrificing quality, but we certainly have an eye toward the economic portion.
Well, we're required to do that. I mean, the legislature requires us to. The legislature requires us to be good fiscal stewards, and I dare say, if you look at our books of this city for the last several years, we've done a very good job in that regard. But
so, and related to this, again, water treatment plant 2 and 3, and there is a power reliability. So if the power goes out, you know, what's the backup power? There's always a backup with drinking water, with wastewater treatment facilities. There has to be power in place to operate that facility 100% if there's interruption in power, whether it's a system-wide problem from the power supplier Duke, or whether it's a hurricane that comes through, a natural disaster or whatever, those facilities have to continue to operate. And that's what these projects do, is make sure that those continue to operate. At Water Treatment Plant 3, as I indicated before, there was testing that was done. The wire is degrading. So now that we have made a decision, that's going to be documented so that the professionals that were involved, it'll be memorialized, it was documented. This is why we're making the decision and moving forward. And then we have guidance on how to make the design plans and move forward from there.
Will you make sure that you get a consultant to carefully look at grounding of the equipment? Because we're in, you know, lightning, very high lightning area of the country, and proper
yes.
grounding can avoid a lot of these problems, right? So
that's
is that going to be part of the?
Actually, part of the Water Treatment Plant 2 project. I personally went through the specifications, and part of that is they have to test the grounding when they're there to make sure that it supplies enough. And the same thing at Water Treatment Plant 3. That'll be part of the project. Initially, there were some components, as Mr. Boyle had indicated, there were some components that were not grounded properly. Why? Don't know. But it caused some damage. That has been fixed. When it occurred, we had it investigated, and that's what the situation was. It was when it was installed, whenever that was, It wasn't grounded properly. It's grounded properly now, so that problem should not occur again.
So, Todd, in your estimation, I mean, we're still in hurricane season, but in your estimation, should we have a storm come through, everything should be ready to withstand that?
That's correct. Okay. Right now, we've taken the exercises. We've done field exercises to make sure that backup's there. We have the projects in place as we move forward. So the intention is to have these done before next season comes around, or at least substantially in that direction.
2 years ago when that big hurricane came through, we had major problems, and we had public works people running from place to place with generators. This is going to alleviate that.
Well, let's clarify a little bit. At the water treatment facilities, the general intent is to put backup generators in place so they don't have that problem. Lift stations are out in the community. It's out in the community, and there are occasions where generators may have to be moved from place to place, and that's typical.
Okay.
Because the expense to actually put the expense, ongoing expense, as well as the capital expense to put generators or backup pumps at every lift station is very, very large. And it's a huge expense to try and do. So it's not uncommon for lift stations to move generators around, but at fixed facilities, such as the water plants and the wastewater plants, you have a generator in place, automatic transfer switch, power automatically switches, operation continues without interruption.
And we have the three water treatment plants. There's the one on the west side, and then are these two on what's considered the east side, or where are these two located? I know the general idea, but somebody in the audience might not.
So water treatment plant one is in the near Trotwood Park.
Mm-hmm.
Water treatment plant two is in the northwest part of the city in the Highlands.
Highlands.
I believe that's called the Highlands. And then water treatment plant three is towards the southwest part of the city.
Kind of in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Off of the Edgemond area.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And Commissioner Hubby, just to save Lena a trip, we have made significant improvements and progress on putting emergency generators on the key lift stations. Yes. I can't tell you how many, but it's been significant.
There's eight of them.
And I know that we've discussed if a new development comes in to adding that as part of the agreement that a backup generator is at a lift station. So that will, hopefully we'll never have a hurricane like the one we had 2 years ago, but we all know that, yeah, we've been lucky so far this year. Fingers crossed.
Commissioner Kendrick.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. A couple of things. We're going back and forth from water treatment, wastewater treatment. I just want to make sure everyone completely understands what we're talking about when we're talking about it. You hear Todd has spoken about holes and seals, things like that. That's purely wastewater. When we're talking about our water treatment, we're talking about emergency and redundancy systems, as well as taste and smell and aesthetics. When we're talking about wastewater treatment plants, now we're talking about the 7 to 10 year plan, replacement, trying to extend its life, trying to save the taxpayer dollars, trying to get the most out of what we have, keep the assets, and improve on those assets. And then Commissioner Hubby brought up the storm, hurricane, I don't remember what it was called.
Irma.
And we actually never went down. We're the only city out of seven cities in Seminole County that did not have a wastewater sewage backup. We didn't have one reported. Not to say that other cities are doing anything wrong. It was just, you know, we had a really incredible public works team out there, you know, sacrificing out there, just getting it done. But we have spent, Lena just commented, almost, what, $400,000 in the past couple of years on eight redundancy systems to make sure that those emergency backup generators at those lift stations did not fail anymore. So, I mean, this is all part of the process, something that started almost 2 years ago. It is a step-by-step process, but it is part of our waterworks plan. That was actually started about 9 years ago, and we've really, in the past 2 years, taken giant leaps forward, And we're going to continue doing that for the next 7 to 10 years for the next 40 years. So, and this is all wastewater. Water treatment plant that he's talking about, that is purely the redundancy systems on making sure that these systems are working and they have the backup qualities that are quite frankly replacing dilapidated systems from decades past. Taste, smell, aesthetics are number one when it comes to that. We're looking at these reports and it looks really good. I just wanted to make sure, because we're jumping back and forth, everyone knows what we're talking about when we're talking about it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. The last slide relates to the reuse system. What this project involves is going ahead, and the Tuscarora Crossing subdivision currently has a separate reuse system installed, but it currently uses, is supplied by potable water for irrigation. Mm-hmm. So what this application was to the Water Management District was hopefully to get co-funding to not only tie in that subdivision, but do some improvements that in the long term overall will work into an overall reclaimed water master plan, where the pipes need to go, what sizes they need to go, what communities need to be served, that kind of thing. But the objective with this project is co-funding to try and get grant dollars from the Water Management District to help offset those costs. And with that, any questions?
I do have a couple more. If you would go to the last presentation on July 13th of this year, the PowerPoint where we looked at trihalomethanes. Yep, that's it. Okay, so this shows from 2014 through 2020, the trihalomethanes in the city of Winter Springs. There was a period of time when they were elevated, and then I recall that starting in 2015, the commission did a pilot program and got engineers and spent over $6 million to put an ion exchange plant into water treatment plant number one. And it looks like from this, there's an error that says IEX startup. Is that the ion exchange startup of that $6 million plant?
That's correct.
And it went online about February of 2017, as I recall. And once that plant came online, the trihalomethane levels were all in compliance. Is that accurate?
That's my understanding.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And the outside engineering firm, Kimley Horn, that did this report to us just 2 months ago, also looked at stage two, HAA5S. What is HAA5S? Yeah.
Okay, that's the halocetic acid, right. And it's an indicator.
But again, we've been well below the permissible limits on that, going all the way back to, looks like, 2014. And again, when we started the ion exchange plant, that also helped. You were present when they did the presentation, when Kimley Horn did the presentation back on July 13th of this year. And the engineer with Kimley Horn concluded that our water system is in compliance with state and federal regulations. And do you share that same opinion?
I do.
Okay. And there's one other thing. If you could put the excerpts up from the Veolia contract, it's on that thumb drive. You're a professional engineer, but you work with Veolia. And the city hired your company, Veolia, on October 21st of 2019. So Veolia has been at the helm just slightly under a year, a few weeks short of a year. And I've seen a lot of individuals perhaps misunderstanding. I've seen repeated representations made by a couple of individuals with an organization that said that this contract was a no-bid multi-million dollar contract. And on the first page of it, it says that the owner, the city, initiated a competitive bidding process. And state law requires a competitive bidding process, and this was a bidding process, RFQ, that was done, and you were one of multiple companies that bid on this project. Fair enough, this contract?
That's correct.
Okay. So much for the suggestion that we have a non-bid, a no-bid, multi-million dollar contract. State law, city manager, doesn't even allow us to do that, does it, on a contract of this size?
No, in fact, we had an early bid protest from the competitors.
Okay. The next thing is on page 7 of the contract, section 3.14. I've heard a bunch of people saying, well, the city needs to do outside independent laboratory testing of the water. And what I thought I heard from Lena Rivera, our engineer, and also from your engineers, and from CPH, and also from Kimley Horn, and also Corolla engineers, is that the water coming out of the tap that's tested is tested by an outside laboratory, is it not?
That's correct.
That's what the state law requires, correct?
It requires third-party validation,
correct,
and approval.
And that's the key, so that anybody listening to this tonight, or if there's anybody that listens to this later, for years, the regulations have required, you know, you don't let the fox count the chickens, right? So you don't let the fox do their own chemical testing of the water. So it has gone out to the outside. And one of the companies that has been used is in Altamont Springs called Advanced Environmental Laboratories. And can you put that up? It says AEL on the thumb drive. And they're a state license. They're licensed by the Department of Health, the Department of Environmental Protection, and they're certified to do just this type of drinking water testing, microbiology, drinking water, and so forth, right? So that was a company, and now there's another one as well called Pace Environmental?
Pace Environmental Labs, same situation.
State certified?
State certified. They have to follow all of the rules from the National Laboratory Certification Arrangement. So it's the same thing. They have to
okay. They
have to comply those and be state.
And that company is also local. It's right up in Daytona Beach.
That's correct.
Advanced Environmental Labs is in Altamont Springs. They're nearby. They're local companies that do the testing.
That's correct.
All right. Now, I've also had people say that we need to get outside consultants to come in and evaluate our operations with the water and the quality and how we're operating the plants. I've seen that all over social media as well. And I remember when we adopted this contract about a year ago, we as a commission asked to put in a trust but verify clause in the Veolia contract. And it's found on page 20, section 14.1. And it says that owner, which is the city, that we retain the services of an independent engineering firm with expertise in water, sewer, reclaimed, and stormwater utilities operations, maintenance, and management to conduct periodic inspection and performance audits of basically this contract and the plants and how you guys are operating them. And those examples of those that we've already been using would be Kimley Horn, Corolla Engineers, CPH Engineers. Fair enough?
Correct.
And those are all professional engineering firms that have been in business for decades with expertise in water, sewer, reclaimed water, and things like that, right?
Yes.
So we've already been doing that, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, one final thing. If you would put up the video from that July, there is the video from the July 13, 2020. So this was the video presentation. You can see Mr. Evans sitting right there in front of the screen. James Evans is there, and you can see the screen in the background. It was about a 20-minute presentation, and they went through the same slides in the PowerPoint, remember, Todd, that we just went through on the trihalomethanes. And also we went through the work in progress bar graphs showing many of these projects you just described with implementation schedules like July to August and August to September, different things. So all of these, we have a plan, and we're working to the plan. Is that a fair statement to say?
Absolutely.
Okay. Would you advance the clock on that, please, to 18 minutes and 27 seconds. And that's where Mr. Luttrell is talking. It's kind of his wrap-up. Okay, stop right there. What's the clock? What's the bottom of the, what is the time stamp on the bottom? Okay, so as you see right there, it says estimated schedule with coronavirus. And the coronavirus caveat was, of course, a lot of things were delayed because of coronavirus. But it shows right there that the hydraulic model in Flushing was done between July and August. That's already been finished. And that was necessary so that we could put the automatic flushers around the city in the water pipeline so that we could make sure the water stayed fresh and reduce trihalomethanes.
That's correct.
And improve odor and taste. The well inspections, you showed us that earlier. That was in July and August. Water treatment plant 1 pH adjustment test, that's been completed. The new chemical point, that's what you described for us earlier, where you're going to try injecting the chlorine at a different point, hopefully using less chlorine, making it a more efficient disinfection. And also another benefit would be to help further reduce trihalomethane. And the number one complaint that I'm hearing from my residents primarily is chlorine taste and smell. And that would be one of the desired goals, is to reduce some of the aesthetic chlorine taste and smell by changing that, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. The water quality study has been done. That Corolla was doing that part of it?
Water quality assessment was the study by Kimley Horn.
Oh, by Kimley Horn. Okay, good. And then the power reliability, that was the generators and so forth that you talked about for both water treatment plant 2 and 3. Okay, so this was all presented on July 13th of 2020 in a 20-minute, very detailed presentation at which we had four engineers present with combined professional engineering experience of probably close to 100 years between you and Lena and Lance and the Corolla engineer.
The Corolla, yes.
And that's not even counting. The CPH wasn't at this particular one on July 13th. Okay, now if you would advance it to 18 minutes and 27 seconds, please. It's right towards the end.
So wrap it up, I'll leave you with a couple of key points that I think are important for you as a community to know. The city takes approximately 700 samples per year. So a lot of testing, a lot of investigative work that goes on from the city staff looking at water quality. The approximate expenditure of that is about $20,000, depending on whether or not we're sampling for 70 or after. Some are, a lot of them are going to be sampled in 2020. Expect that number to go up slightly. In addition to that, as we noted before, we've kind of handled the DPHM issue and that compliance area. So now we're focusing on improving water back, looking at those aesthetic requirements that are not regulatory requirements, but just improving aesthetics. So as the city pulled us in as the first pass to get us started on looking at this water quality, we have not worked for the city, haven't looked at the water quality data, until this project, and that's when they brought me in and said, hey, can you review this as kind of an independent person, kind of been engaged in the city and our water work program. And after reviewing the data, I can say that your water system is in compliance and we are meeting all federal and state regulations.
Okay. And you agree with that conclusion as a professional engineer as well?
Yes.
But we brought in an outside independent firm, Mr. Luttrell, with a very well-respected company, Kimley Horn, and verified the same thing.
Correct.
Same thing that CPH has been telling us, the same thing that you've been telling us, the same thing that, well, in any event. The reason why I'm going back over this is because there continues, for whatever reason, to be some misunderstanding or confusion or perhaps deliberate misinformation suggesting that we have a crisis in the city with our water. The trihalomethanes, those chemical substances, that's not a chlorine smell, is it?
Correct.
Okay. So if somebody is equating a smell, a chlorine or sulfur type smell coming out of their faucet to trihalomethanes and cancer, there's no correlation there, is there, sir?
There is not. You're correct.
Okay. In the concentrations of trihalomethanes were present, they would essentially be odorless and tasteless for any human beings. I mean, these are at parts per billion that they test them for, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah.
It's a trihalomethane is an odorless, colorless constituent. So it's any detection from odor or from a smell or something that someone may experience has no relation to what a THM level may be.
Okay. So I want to emphasize that again, because again, there's a lot of conflation or sort of combining. There's been a lot of repeat information floating around in this city that because some people, not the entire city, have concerns about the chlorine or maybe sulfur sort of taste and smell in their water, that must be the trihalomethane and we're all going to get cancer. And they are completely separate and distinct. Is that fair to say?
Yes.
And that's your opinion as a professional engineer, sir?
Yes.
And one that has spent like 25 years in this specific industry?
Yes.
Of water and sewer and utilities?
That's correct.
Okay. So I'm hoping that anybody who's here listening will take the time, please, to look at the full 20-minute video that's on the city website and has been up there since July 13th or 14th, so that you can watch it for yourself, look at the PowerPoint presentations, review this for yourself, because sometimes what you read and hear on social media is just not accurate. Perhaps well-intentioned, but it's just not accurate. And I've got people coming to me freaking out about cancer clusters and the rest of that, but this information is the engineering information from experts that have been coming to us. It's not myself or the commission making this conclusion. It's the conclusion of over 100 years worth of professional engineers and chemists that have been doing this work for the city and reporting back to us. And I want to thank you, Todd, for the rapidity with which you're making these plant upgrades, because we know there was a lot of cans at some of these plants that were kind of kicked down the road and ignored for too long. And we're working on it as diligently as you can. What do you think the delay, not delay, but what do you think the realistic time when, I know we waited months to get DEP to approve that ion exchange resin plant. I mean, that's a long process. How long for the modification of that manifold and the different point of injecting the chlorine into the system? Do you think you can fast track that through DEP?
So with DEP, we actually had pre-application conference calls with DEP to explain the project to them so that they were aware. Did they have any concerns up front? And so we do not anticipate any delays in obtaining approval from DEP for that. As far as the construction itself, again, the current timeline is intended to bring that project for commission consideration in December. When that actually gets constructed will a little bit depend, again, on when the piping and the pipe manufacturer, whoever that may be, actually delivers the material.
Right.
Because, again, this isn't material somebody can go to Home Depot and buy. This is large diameter pipe. It has to be special ordered. And in today's day and age, they manufacture it when it's ordered.
Right.
That's how today's world is.
Okay.
In many businesses.
So, okay. Todd, I have a question with Veolia. Since it's such a large company, does it have some leverage, if you will, to perhaps fast track some of these parts that are so difficult to attain?
So that's interesting. Not with piping, we don't, but as it relates to some of the components at the wastewater plants, I actually have already pursued that because the vendor that was providing those particular components, I pursued that through our channels and ability to try and leverage that and get them to respond. They did not like me calling them, but I did same to pressure them into delivering our components now because we need them. So that's the type of thing that a lot of times I do is behind the scenes is leveraging some of those vendors to deliver our materials so that we can do the work that desperately needs to be done.
I just have one follow-up. If there's no other questions, I don't want to.
Is there anybody else?
So, Todd, I'm going to ask you again what I've asked every one of these engineers during the last 5 years as we've been going through this process, from CPH to Corolla to Wharton Smith that built that ion exchange plant, as I recall correctly. Do you have any reservations that you need to bring to the attention of the commission? You know, none of us are engineers. None of us are chemists. None of us are water experts. So we rely on hiring really good and really expensive experts to guide us. And so if you know of anything that we need to know, don't look over at Sean or anybody else, but please tell us right now, is there anything else that we can be doing that we're not doing, that we've overlooked, or are we moving as rapidly and as efficiently as we can get these upgrades done? That's really what I want to know.
Right. We're moving as efficiently and quickly as possible and in compliance with state rules with procurement and everything that needs to be done.
Right, because we got to bid stuff out, and then we've got to get the permitting from the state and so forth.
That's correct. There's Florida Department of Environmental Protection permits, which have to be obtained. There's state procurement rules, which have to be followed. There's time it takes to do it methodically and execute properly and with proper due diligence. But
okay. No,
the path forward looks very bright.
For myself, I can't speak for the rest of the commission, although I would dare say they probably share the same opinion. At any time during these processes, if you or Veolia or any of these other engineering firms feel like you need to come to us and bring something to our attention, it is an open door. Please reach out to us, come before us. If we've got to find some more money, if we've got to find whatever, additional manpower or expertise, do not hesitate to come to the commission, because I think everyone up here would agree. Mm-hmm. We are committed to handling these issues that have been kicked down the road for too long, and we've been working really diligently, especially the last 2 to 3 years on this, and we want to continue to do that. So please come in and tell us if there's anything else that we need to know. Okay, will you do that?
Absolutely.
Thank you, Todd.
Todd, thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.